and butterfly, in which the what the body that's identified as Asian is exoticized and made into this kind of two-dimensional kind of cartoon figure. And I think David Wang also knows that, and he's very aware of it. And he knows that it's a really fine balance. You know, as soon as you put something on stage, it's immediately made into a spectacle. I mean, that's kind of an inherent part of what theater does. And is it possible to read an Asian body on stage as what Ju-Yun Kim would call the mundane? Like, can the Asian body on stage be mundane, right? Is that even possible? Is that paradoxical? So is it possible for Asian person to just eat a sandwich on stage and not make it about Asian person eating sandwich, but just somebody eating sandwich, right? How do you reconcile this kind of convention kind of tradition in European dominated theater, Euro-American theater, that has always exoticized Asian bodies? And is it really, when can we, I mean, that's my question, when can we actually see it as a kind of mundane-ness? And that, and Ji-Yong Kim, I think, does a really great job in her book, Racial Mundane, exploring those things.
Just to follow up on your question about eating a sandwich on stage, what about just talking? I'm curious, you mentioned at the beginning that the actor who plays Bruce has a strong accent at the beginning of the play. Does that continue on throughout the entire play?
The actor doesn't, but the character does.
Right.
So yes, it continues throughout the play.
So I guess the larger question I want to ask is whether choreography and just focus on the corporeality of the body comes at the expense of self-expression through language.
Yeah, I think this is why Huang said he could not make Bruce Lee sing. I mean, I think there's a lot there. I mean, it's kind of a joke, but it is a lot, because I think once you have Bruce Lee speak the way he speaks on stage, it becomes comical. And it is comical when Huang, I think, deliberately writes the scene as comedy, so it's not just Bruce Lee was funny and everybody else is serious, but the whole scene is funny. But I think that's why he could not make him sing. It would just be funny, right? So how do you make Bruce Lee, be really this kind of really attractive, masculine Asian body on stage? And how do you navigate that potential really, really easy way to fall into comedy? I think he sacrifices language and complexity of plot, character development, that is sacrificed to showcase, I think, what for Huang is the most kind of best part of Bruce Lee, which is kind of his body and movement. Yeah. So, I mean, I think that's what critics have said too, because the plot is so shallow, characters are very shallow. And I think Huang, it was just, I know he struggled with this play for many years, and he could not make Bruce Lee speak and sing on stage. In some ways, it's a failure of a playwright to do that. So, okay, let's have him dance. Right, show off his body instead.
One quick question. Would you recommend Kung Fu? You said it did terribly in terms of criticism. Maybe.
I mean, it's really good entertainment. That's the thing about critics. They're too serious, right? But it was, as a theatrical entertainment, I thought it was amazing. And I thought it was just such a really different experience to see a danceical. I mean, I would recommend that. The problem is, it would be impossible to cast.
Oh, right. You should have the virtuosity, right?
You
as
need
a
to
martial
have
arts.
Somebody who could
artist.
Dance and do kung fu at the same time.
Right.
So I don't think it would be revived. I mean, I don't know. Maybe in Korea or anywhere in Asia where there's a wider pool of actors, you might be able to do this.
This is an embarrassing question, but did Bruce Lee in real life speak in that way?
Yes.
I can't remember. Oh.
Yeah, so that's how I wanted to show you the video. So if you actually, but the way he does it is really cool. But if anybody else tries to imitate it, it just looks really weird. Only Bruce Lee can speak like that. Yeah, he did. And then he does, in a way, kind of like a fortune cookie type of talk. Like the sentence, like really wise. But, you know, Americans loved it.
I did my BA in English Literature. I just was invited and came here. My name is Judy. I'm actually curious on how you think about Huang's, like, personally, like, if you think Huang has a fundamental understanding about like actually what China is or like what is actual like his ethnicity, because for me, I grew up in Korea, spent most of my life elsewhere, and came back. And even in trying to find Chinatown, anywhere else, the feeling I got from his work is that I can't be very sophisticated in my wording, but it's through a vision of a Chinese American. It's not a Chinese person who saw it. And when it's always bilateral, like American culture versus Chinese culture, but in my belief, he has a fine understanding about what American is, American culture is, but does he really have an understanding about what Chinese culture is? I don't think so. And I think one of the reasons why you talked about how he's a token of American, Asian American theater and all that, and I think there is some truth in there, because Huang could be like a filter where there is this raw Chinese culture, and through a filter of a Chinese American playwright who has successfully assimilated to mainstream culture in America, he filters that raw culture into something that is acceptable by the white mainstream American pop culture, and hence Kung Fu.
Yeah.
And I don't think that's a drawback. It's one part of the whole thing, but
he would be the first one to tell you that he doesn't know Chinese culture, nor Chinese. He doesn't speak Chinese at all. His father was a banker. He was the first Asian American banker, Cathay Bank, now East West Bank. And his father did not allow he and his sister to speak Chinese at home. He was told to encourage to completely assimilate. And when he wrote Chinglish, because that's a bilingual play, he had a Chinese-speaking, basically a dramaturg, assistant playwright, write kind of half of the play, right? So the American audience or the producers some may not know the difference, but they may see him as primarily an ambassador of China, maybe an expert in China, and Huang, he is aware of that, and he, if I could go back to the table of contents, so this is a right before M. Butterfly, he wrote a play called Rich Relations, and this is a play with no Asia character. This is about yuppies, like really rich white people who worry about useless things. really rich people. but it failed miserably. It was the biggest flop of his life. It's not a bad play. It's a really interesting play because it's really about their life, this shiny life, just getting destroyed by their greed and Huang then followed that up with the most exotic play in his career. And ever since then, he's never in a play that has only all white characters. All of his plays ever since then have something to do with Asian, or what mainstream theater people would recognize as Asian. So it's, if we wrote another play that had all like non-Asian characters, would it do well? I'm not sure. It's kind of his brand now.
One of the things that drew me to this event was at the bottom of the posters was about glocal, so I appreciated the wording. But in with that idea, do his heroes and legends, either out of the Kung Fu play, or do his heroes and legends out of the other plays, do they compare and contrast with Asian legends and heroes fairly well, or other European or American ways that legends and heroes are depicted and brought out in other plays?
Besides Bruce Lee.
Besides Bruce Lee.
I think you could say every single one of his plays have to do with legends and heroes. Like FOB has Guan Gong, who's a Chinese god of war.
Mm-hmm.
And the FOB character says, "I am Guan Gong." He declares that, right? So he, Frank Chen hates him, kind of criticizes, "You got it all wrong. It's not the right god." And Dance on the Railroad is about Chinese laborers in on the West Coast in the 19th century. And he makes a hero out of those laborers, so-called coolies, right? Yeah, so every single one of these. But at the same time, he has a sense of kind of sarcasm that a lot of people don't get. Like, M. Butterfly is a very sarcastic play. Most people produce it too seriously, and it just becomes a really boring play. But it has to be really tongue-in-cheek, kind of sarcastic. Like, look what I'm doing, like, and a wink at the audience. And I think some of that comes from his Christian family background. He grew up a very fundamentalist Christian. And in college, he denounces it. So family devotion, that play is about his family. His grandmother coming saying, you better believe in Jesus or you're going to die in hell. But then like the barbecue goes in fire, and like the house almost burns down. I mean, it's this kind of sarcastic view of like, this divinity or whatever is considered holy and sacred. And he has said that his plays are kind of, it could be both tragedy and comedy. And he says that in his view, anything that human beings experience is tragedy, but the same thing can be seen by a god and his comedy. So he writes plays that are that god's perspective. What could be tragedy would be pretty funny. And it's really fine line. And many directors misinterpret that and then mix it into a tragedy. But Man Butterfly is a comedy, if you really have to look at it. If you look at the original production with John Lithgow and Baby Wong, it's funny. It's really, really funny. So I just saw a trailer for the new production in October. It looks so serious. I'm a little worried. It looks too serious. But it's supposed to be really funny. But yeah, so the Heroes and Legend, yes, he deals with it, but he's also very sarcastic at the same time, and you could read it in multiple novels.
So it takes a level of understanding his local language, his local situation, as it applies to possibly the global.
Yeah. And then, you know, all playwrights do this, but he writes plays that could be interpreted in many, many different levels. Mm-hmm. So, and Butterfly has a character, the comrade Chin, who is a really, really stereotypical Asian, like this communist, a masculine woman. But then he said that that was a comic character, and he wanted the audience to laugh, and people just kind of all like took it really seriously. again. So yeah, but then that's also kind of an inside joke to Asian Americans. Because Asian Americans, when they see it, would know that's just ridiculously funny, because it's this ridiculous stereotype. But if you're not Asian American, you may think, oh, that's a real Chinese communist leader, right? He does a lot of inside joke with Asian Americans. So yeah, it's local in that sense, but he doesn't force that. You're encouraged to interpret it at your own level.
For some clarification, that global English literature is the department's motto, not her. Actually, that's a question that should have been asked to the head of the program, sitting right there. But anyway, you answered.
Yeah.
I'm personally intrigued by the concept of magic realism, and how to apply. I'm wondering how it applies to the notion of Asian American identity and stereotype. Because in my understanding, magic realism is a originally post-colonial concept, which is anti-rationalist, and there's just a lot of fluidity. And there are these stereotypes of Asians that they are mysterious, uncivilized. If you rely on this notion of magic realism, it seems to reaffirm the Orientalist understanding of Asians, right? They're mysterious. We can't really understand them. They're different from us. So how that works in terms of the identity politics?
That's a good point. I mean, there's danger of that happening. But I think he tries to flip it. So the section that I skipped, actually, is about magic realism. Like FOB, the play, FOB with FOB and ABC, that play takes place in the back of a Chinese restaurant, back room. And what that means is, like, you know, when a typical American who does not know Asian American culture thinks of something Chinese, they think of a Chinese restaurant. It's the most accessible space. And they usually think of the Golden Dragon, red, whatever, that kind of decor they think of in kind of American Chinese restaurant. But everyone sets the play behind that, like behind that. It's almost similar to, if you know Yong Jin Lee's plays, Songs of Dragon, she does the same thing. She sets the play behind that shiny, really, you know, pretty orientalist decor. So in that space, backstage, because Huang is really interested in the face and what's behind the face, the mask and what's behind the face. He's interested in the behind that space, that back space. And there, anything can happen in the Hong Kong's world. And it becomes kind of a portal. It becomes like this really magic reality where reality and fantasy collide. You know, that's the kind of space he writes about a lot. A lot of his plays are set in spaces like that, like private, behind the set stage. And I think that's why he writes for theater.
Okay.
But I think theater is the only genre of writing that could really explore the facade and the back. Because it's physically there in front of you, right?
Mm.
But he kind of turns that on the audience. Let me show you the backside of what really happens. Okay?
So it's mainly aesthetics rather than politics.
It could be politics too. It could be politics too. Because every Asian American saying, you could go out to the restaurant hall and be really Chinese. I'll give you a fork and then you'll be really, really, especially if you're a waitress like Grace is. You could do that. But behind the scene, you are just a human being. You're an Asian American, not a Chinese waitress. So Huang is interested in that private space in which you perform one identity, but then you become another identity, and kind of transition back and forth.
I guess we have a little time left for one more question. In case I forget, let me remind you that there will be a luncheon at the Korean Fusion Restaurant Ramadi, and all of you here are invited. Please join us. Do not walk away.